Well, good morning, Andover. Welcome to Town TV. Don't forget, you can ring us on Andover 333 983. It's Andover 333 983. With any questions or tell us what's going on in Andover. There's a lot going on. It's a grey old February day, but as I say, welcome to the show. This week we've got all sorts of things. We've got George Melly down at the Cricklade. We've even got, we've got a bit of boxing for you, and we're going to try and get that edited for you later. Poor Steve's been a bit ill this week, so sorry for the delay in getting a show out, but Steve was on his sick bed, weren't you, Steve? But never mind, he's looking much better now. His little cheery face the other side of the camera, but anyway, he's feeling much better. Anyway, first this week, I just want to say, this, when is it? Saturday, Steve? Saturday. Down at the George, down at the George Inn in Andover High Street, the one and only Georgie Fame is going to be there. And do you remember back in the summer when we were going to put on the concert down in Charlton, and we couldn't in the end? But Georgie Fame has kindly said he'll come up to the George in Andover on Saturday evening. So it's about 8 o'clock. He's going to perform with his two sons. I mean, you don't often get somebody like Georgie Fame in Andover. So turn up at George Inn, 8 o'clock, Saturday evening. We'll be there, so it's going to be a great show by Georgie with his jazz. So it's going to be fantastic. Anyway.
Give us a date of that.
The date? I don't know. What's the date on Saturday? Must be...
I think it's 7th today, so it's Tuesday. Wednesday, 8th.
It must be the 11th. It must be the 11th. Morning, Andover. It's the 11th, Saturday 11th. So if you're watching the show after that, you missed it. But George is going to be there. Anyway, a lot of things going on. We've got Roger Daltry. We did a film of Roger Daltry down in the Caribbean. That was great. He was big game fishing. So I'm going to show a bit of that as well. There's all sorts of stuff happening. So, Steve, start editing. Take it away.
Walker's Key in the Bahamas is a small island jutting out in the Atlantic. It's one of the 700 islands and inlets that stretch from the coast of Florida to Haiti to form the Abaco chain. And it's here that each year the World Game Fishing Championships are held. Enhanced with an ideal climate, a maximum yearly rainfall of 50 to 60 inches, and temperatures in the summer months between 80 and 90 degrees Fahrenheit, the 100,000 or more square miles of shoals and banks with their warm waters from the Gulf Stream and the steady trade winds from the southeast encourage some of the best game fishing in the world. Walker's Key's aircraft flies in one of the contestants to participate in this 13th annual Billfish Tournament. Roger Daltry, better known as rock star from The Who, actor and composer, but who also owns a trout fishing farm in Sussex. He will take his place amongst the 131 anglers competing on board 81 boats. He'll be guided through his first tournament by professional angler Trevor Housby, who fishes this tournament regularly, and won it in 1979 by catching a 561-pound blue marlin. The only formality left now is the customs shed. From then on, competitiveness is at its peak when everyone tests his odds in the big game.
The beautiful thing about hooking a big fish is the fact that when there's just you, a rod, and a line that joins you to that fish, and you can almost feel him breathe. You can feel what's going on down there. You feel for a start when you first start fighting, the fish is confident. Nothing's ever upset him, nothing's ever bothered him. He thinks he can break anything and everything. And after a while, you can sense that sort of nerve beginning to crack at the other end. And that's when you get your second wind, because you take quite a beating on a big fish, you know, a physical beating. A lot of people try to rush it and try to work too hard in the first 10 minutes. And then they spend 3, 4, 5 hours on a fish. I like to build up to it steadily and get him in the boat as fast as possible. But once you begin to feel him crack, then you can pile on the pressure. And about that stage, I start talking to him. And I really frankly believe he probably is talking to me, but in an entirely different way, you know. And I don't know, there's this feeling of gaining an inch of line, even an inch, half an inch. You're pushing that reel spool just gently, you know, and you're putting it, all your back muscles, your legs, everything's working. And you're trying to get that fish to come up, to get closer and closer. And, you know, the inch turns into a yard, the yard maybe comes 5 yards. Suddenly you're working him well and you're getting the line back and he's gone again, you know? Tremendous speed. But you know that you've got his nerve.
We're doing all right.
Roger's a good guy. Certainly likes to fish. I don't think he's done a lot of big game fishing, but he's done enough to know what he's doing. And I think he'll adapt very well. And I'm sure he's going to like the island and he's going to like the people. And I think they're going to like him because he's a decent guy. I mean, being a famous sort of rock star sounds, you know, a terrible thing really to suddenly dump one in the middle of a small island. But Roger's the sort of person that you could actually put on an island like this. And he would fit in nicely. And I think it'll be a great experience fishing with him. A lot of fun.
We've raised fish, so maybe tomorrow we'll be lucky.
Well, I think we'll do it,
haven't we? It's a billfish tournament, which means that they're fishing blue marlin, white marlin, spearfish and sailfish. They get other fish, but they're the main things in the whole tournament. And it's a thing that brings anglers from all over the world. We've got anglers in from Australia this year. A lot of American anglers, we've got the British anglers, myself and Roger Daltry. And the object is, you know, competition over a period of 5 days. Everybody's got a chance. Everybody can walk away with a super prize and be the world champion. That's about what it is, you know. It's the biggest billfish tournament in the world. And the fishing's good here in Walker's Quay. And it's a very, very exciting tournament. And I enjoy it. I've fished it for a number of years. I won it 1 year, which was nice, and it's never been won twice by the same guy. I'm going to try this year, and hopefully we'll get near it anyway. I'd like to get placed.
Careful planning and thought are necessary aids in this sport, in which the winner depends largely on luck. Billy Black, a chartered skipper, shows Roger Daltry the ropes. It's a complete change in style from riverbanks and fly fishing.
It's not that serious as it thinks until you really get him on. Then it's your job. Then it becomes real work.
That's right.
If you got a minute, we'll set you down here and adjust up the harness and see how it looks, you know. So why don't you have a seat and a chair here and we'll show you what you're working with. You're used to fishing those fly rods over in the mountain,
I'm
right?
A trout fisherman, yeah. That's a little bit bigger.
All right. Well, first of all, I'm going to make sure we get the harness set. You can lift up yourself and sit right on this harness.
Sit in it.
Get up, sit. We're going to put you right on him, boy. You're going to know when you got him on. Okay, next we're going to set the rod and the gimbal here. Adjust up the harness to make sure you got the proper length. Now hold your forearm, your left hand out on the grip. Grab the rod. Again, we snap you in here. Now, you have to do this during the tournament because it's all IGFA, and you have to snap this in yourself. All right?
Yeah.
Now, once you get in, you got the fish on. You're going to get him in the chair. Then it's all up to you. You slide your legs forward. Slide forward. The fish is on us. Push back with your legs. Push back and crank with this hand. Like this, all right? Slide forward. Way back. Pull back on the fish. It's hard. I'm easy. Pull back on him and crank on the way down. That's almost all there is to it. Now, if a fish is on really greyhounding away from you, hold the rod lower, low as you can, and just glide. The boat's going to be burning back on you.
Don't wake me up if I should be dreaming. I don't want to miss one minute of this dream. Don't worry now, 'cause you're not dreaming. I'll love you always, wherever you be. Oceans away, go where you may, and love will be with you. Oceans away, and love will be with you. Oceans away. Night is cold, but day. Twilight zone can last very long.
Fishing for this event takes place daily between 8:30 and 17:30 for 5 days. Some may make a catch within seconds of casting their lines, whereas others could still be waiting for that bite at the end of the contest.
The chances of winning, every angler likes to believe he's going to win. We're certainly going to give it a try, we're going to give it our best. And, I mean, there's not a lot of actual prize money involved in a thing like this. What is involved is cups and shields and presentation pieces and the kudos of winning the tournament. Basically, a marlin's an oceanic wanderer, you know, it's a migratory species. They come here to feed them before going north. This is a great feeding ground, one of the last before they go up to Hatteras. And they're basically loners, although you'll often find three or four around a big bunch of bait fish. But usually they're on their own, so I've never really seen marlin actually actively working in groups. I've seen what they call double headers, two strikes at the same time. I've even once seen a triple header, which is very unusual, three marlin hit simultaneously. But that's simply because there are three or four or six marlin surrounding a bunch of bonito or flying fish or whatever they were feeding them. Skippers and mates are some of the most important people anyway in the tournament. I mean, you can be a good angler, but if you haven't got a good skipper and a good mate out in the cockpit fishing, then you're wasting your time. These men make these tournaments, and of course they are marlin crazy. They've all got marlin fever. They live, eat and sleep marlin, marlin bait, and that's all they want to do is fish marlin. It's a sort of Wild West situation from 100 years ago. They're really the last of the gunfighters, you know, these guys that run these boats. And that's how they see themselves, you know, the last outpost of civilization hunting these great fish.
Tension is mounting now that the contest is well underway. Every piece of equipment so necessary to catch that big one is being put to its use. Temperature gauges, echo sounders, fish finders, Lorraines, and tuna towers are the trusty aids in this battle. Tony Iruza, aboard Sylvia, tops the bill so far with a catch of four blue marlin, totaling in weight 512 pounds. But close behind is Jeff Thomas and Midnight Sun, with his two fish catch totaling 508 pounds. Bum Runner, Screaming Eagle, Grand Slam, Gone Catching, Big Red, Slime Mongoose, After Hours and Seafood Platter. Their cost ranging from $51,000 to over $1 million each, returned to stock the harbour with a total of a $50 million boat investment. Occasionally, though, the fish get their own back.
Hooked up on a marlin, and we only were fighting it 15 minutes or so. It was really green fish. Got him up close to the boat, and we finally where we could gaff him, and when he came in the boat, before we gaffed him, we had to pull it over the side. Like today was kind of rough out there. We had really big seas, so the boat laid into the side of the trough a little bit. So when we're pulling the boat over the fish over the gunwale, the mate was, and I had the head with a flying gaff, the mate had the bill. When he was pulling it in, we had hit a wave just right and just turned just right, and the fish came actually flying in. And the mate slipped with the fish in his hand, with the bill in his hand, and went to his leg anyway. We tried to kill the fish as fast as I was afraid, and it just went through right here, and it had a big hole where it didn't go all the way through, but it was, you could see where it punctured in there, and he was stuck on it. I was trying to get his leg undone and try to kill the fish fast before it tore up, because the fish was very green.
I won't be back.
The wounded egos of those with the fish that got away stories are nursed with alcohol, sing-songs, and a convivial atmosphere. While those who did manage a catch, however small, can relax in peace, knowing that after it's been smoked and cured, it'll be shipped across to Florida.
Save all your kisses for me. Oh, do you remember that? Brotherhood of Man. I don't sing it very well, but the Brotherhood of Man were down at the Cricklade Theatre. So we went along to watch them in action. And we also went behind the scenes to have a little chat with them. They don't seem aged at all, really, but they had some great big hits a few years ago. So here we go, Brotherhood of Man, live from the Cricklade. Here we are backstage at the Cricklade with Brotherhood of Man. How are you doing? Sandra.
How are you? How are you, Alan?
I'm all right, yeah, it's okay. Welcome to Andover.
Thank you.
So what have you been up to?
Well, actually last year we were very, very busy, and which was, you know, amazing. I mean, nowadays we never know what kind of work is going to come in, hence this theatre tour is really nice for us. But yeah, we had a good year last year, and it looks like the start is really quite good this year.
Fantastic, 95, yeah. Is it normally cabaret or is it theatre work?
Well, we do all sorts. We do a bit of everything, you know, hotels, theatres, holiday camps, you name it, we do it.
This is Lee, by the way. Hello. This is Lee. Yeah. Really nice Fender there. Lee. I got one of those, just the same as that, black and white one, yeah. Oh, well, Clapton's got one too.
He has, that's it. Yeah, well, obviously, the three of us then are in the same league.
Well, probably not, no. Martin, are you enjoying yourself?
Yes, very much so.
Yeah.
Glad you turned up.
Well, we're here, yeah. 1976, that was a big year for you, wasn't it?
You could say that. Yeah, it's a bit like winning the lotto,
yeah.
Sort of thing.
I didn't win tonight either.
Oh, I don't know. I haven't even checked my tickets.
I do.
I haven't even checked my tickets. Who knows?
Rich from the Trogs won this year, didn't he? Well,
yeah, that was great, wasn't it? I mean, great to have the song in a movie, and great, you know, the fact he wrote it, and what a great song anyway. So, you know, it all goes together.
Almost as good as yours in 1976 Eurovision. Pretty good, eh?
What are we? We're coming up for 19 years this year for that song. We've been together 24, so it's 19 years, so maybe some producer out there is looking for a song for a movie.
How come all you guys stuck together? Because that's quite unusual, isn't it?
It is, I suppose, really. 24 years. It's a long time, isn't it? Hopefully we're going to make 30, and after that, who knows, you know? Well, there you go.
What do you think about that, Nikki?
Oh, yes, my bank balance isn't big enough yet, so I'll go on for as long as whatever. Yes. Yeah, well, I mean, we all enjoy working together. I mean, the public still want us out there, otherwise we wouldn't be working. So we'll go on for as long as what we wanted for it.
There's a great revival in all this sort of music. I mean, the Carpenters are back in fashion as well now, aren't they?
That's right. Well, there's, like, you've got the Carpenters show that goes around, which is, you know, performing the sounds of the Carpenters. You've got Bjorn again, which is doing ABBA. You know, but
Daryl Gary did.
We do our own impersonation of the Brotherhood of Man.
we do the original impersonation.
Yes, being the four original.
Do you think I look like Martin Lee from Brotherhood?
I really do.
Yeah, so there you go. I thought I was pretty good.
That is pretty good. I always wear black too.
this is Martin Lee minus 6 pounds because he's on a diet.
Oh, he looks very fit.
Yeah, yeah, almost self-like. You know, well, you gotta look good. You know what I mean? They want to see a movie star. Here I am.
Can we just interrupt just for a minute? There's somebody over in the corner keeps coughing and making
exactly. Our keyboard player.
What,
Timothy.
Timothy.
Timothy, come on.
Timothy, just say hello. What's it like playing with these guys?
It's a great privilege to work for Brotherhood of Man, who, I mean, I was offered Pink Floyd, but I didn't want to do Pink Floyd. Brotherhood of Man was far more preferable.
Really?
No.
Really? Okay.
What about
our
drummer, Alan?
I got a drummer as well. The drummer.
Wonderful drummer. Here he is. Look, very shy.
What's your name?
Colin.
Colin, you play the drums?
I try to play the drums. I own a set of drums, basically, and that's about it.
And you and Timothy, the keyboard player?
Yeah.
What are these guys like? I mean, really, truthfully, we're behind the scenes now, backstage.
Is anybody watching? Yes. They're wonderful. They're smashing to work with. No, they're a great bunch of people. it's
he's
almost
a great liar. It's a tremendous.
What's that wind up behind the back?
I'm paying him. Look at the leg.
We also, not only have we been together all this time, but you know we also keep our musicians quite a while as well. So we are.
Because they're still waiting for the checks.
Yeah, yeah. We don't pay them. Never. Waiting for what? They all want to be famous, and they are. So that's good.
They're all famous in their own right.
Yeah.
Famous in Sandra's living room.
And that's another story. But anyway, you must be a
well, a very happy and great bunch of people to be together so long. I think it's amazing.
That's right. So, I always used to say we never quite got as much publicity, you know, in the papers and things, because I think we're too nice. I know that's ridiculous, but, you know, we never had any drugs, we never took, you know,
smoke. We're going to get onto some crack and some coke and, you know, let's get this party moving, you know.
It's true. We always used to say, what can we do? Because people always used to ask us, you know, now what is it, you know, you must have times when you don't get on or whatever, you know, but, you know, we get over any problems that come up, don't we? And it's true. And I always say, maybe we should have... beating one another up every now and then.
You can edit this, can't you?
Yes.
No.
What, you worried?
Yeah, I don't know. Well, anyway, congratulations. That's all I can say. I mean, absolutely fantastic. And thanks for coming down here, which is absolutely brilliant. Yeah. And I think you're on in about 30 seconds, so we're not going to hold you up. So Ollie's going to follow you onto the stage. So best of luck. Right. Have a good one.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. See you later. Bye-bye.
Need a mobile phone? Then look no further than the Mobile Phone Shop. With phones from £29, line rentals from £8.50 per month, and call charges from just 5p per minute, there is no better value. We can also supply international coverage phones, and we have a complete range of accessories for most makes of mobile phones. Our sales, repair and hire services are second to none. The Mobile Phone Shop, to the Broadway, Andover.
Right, we're in Newbury at Gatsby's Club, but it's lunchtime now, and we've just had a wonderful, wonderful meal. It's worth driving up from Andover for this meal, because it's really special. And with me is the owner, Steve Benson. How are you, Steve?
Fine, thank you.
Thanks for that meal. Really enjoyed it.
You enjoyed it, yeah.
Just getting on to the coffees now, liqueurs after that, but we're not driving. Steve, how long have you been here now?
We've been about 2.5 years, as Gatsby's is a club and a restaurant during the day.
Yeah, but you've been open lunchtimes all that time as well?
Yes, yeah.
And how's business in?
Not too bad, we're sort of riding the recession, so it's fairly good, yeah.
How many nights a week does the club upstairs open?
We're open 4 nights a week, Thursday, Friday, Saturday and Sunday, and both floors are open as a club rather than a restaurant.
But we also have live bands here at times.
We have live bands every Sunday, yes.
Yeah. Can you name a few that's coming soon?
Locomotion, Desire, Kickback, Pang, High Voltage. We sort of vary between different styles of music, being jazz, soul.
Yeah, so you cater for everybody's taste, isn't it? Yeah. What's the sort of age group that comes to the club upstairs?
It varies really. I mean, from sort of 20 to sort of 35, 40.
So I'd be a bit over the top then for that one.
Yeah, probably.
You've got some hair dye, mate. Well, how many staff do you have here?
Full-time, we've only got about 4 staff. I mean, we use a lot of part-time staff. We use a sort of 6-bar staff on of an evening. But 4 full-time and the rest are just part-time.
She is. You want to talk to her?
This is the lady.
That's it. I'm Tash.
You're here every night?
Sorry?
Are you here every night?
Yeah, Fridays and Saturdays mainly.
Do you live in Newbury?
Yeah, Thatcham, just outside.
How long have you lived here?
About 2 years now.
What do you do with yourself when you're not here?
I'm a carpet fitter during the day and...
Sorry?
I fit carpets during the day. So, and then this on Fridays and Saturdays.
We needed him today, didn't we?
Sorry?
Have a joke. you enjoy yourself here, it's a nice club.
Yeah, definitely.
It's very busy, it's fun.
Yeah, I mean, everyone's here to enjoy themselves.
You don't get too much trouble.
Not at all. I mean, it's mainly regulars anyhow, so everyone who comes, you know, are here every week, and they all know the score here. Everyone for a good time. But I hate every minute of this now.
You want to be, you want a bit of their
I was standing behind there earlier on, thinking they can only get the back of me.
Pike. And you're the first lady dawn person.
That's right, yeah, the first registered in Great Britain.
That's quite an achievement, isn't it? Are you enjoying yourself up to now?
Yes, very much so, yeah. Seeing all sorts of different people and all walks of life, really. It's great fun.
Not too much trouble?
No, not too much that we can't handle.
I saw you getting geared up there earlier
yes,
on.
Yeah, I'm also the...
No bulletproof vest or anything like that.
No, I don't think that's necessary.
Do you live in Newbury?
Yes, just outside Newbury. My husband's also the DJ.
Who's he?
Mark Pike.
He's the DJ here.
He's a DJ here tonight.
So it's a family thing.
He's also a registered doorman as well, so if we need extra backup, we just call him.
So it's very much about family thing here then?
We're all like one big family, yes. Team effort.
Oh, it's lovely talking to you. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Wish you love. We've got time for a little 2-minute chat. Okay. We're Town TV.
Hello.
You're the bar lady here at Gatsby's. How long have you worked here?
I've been here about a year now.
And it's a lovely place to work in. Steve's a jolly good manager and stuff, isn't he?
Steve's lovely to work for. Really nice to work for.
And you get really busy. What's your busiest nights?
Fridays, sometimes on a Saturday, anytime sort of from now, we go really, really busy.
If you were going to say to somebody from Andover or the surrounding areas why they should come to Gatsby's, what would you say?
Because it's a good fun night out. Nice place to be. We're open till 1 o'clock. I think they're only charging £1 on the door to get in. So it's cheaper than any nightclub, and you can still drink till the early hours of the morning.
And what's your name?
I'm Nikki.
Nikki. Thank you very much.
Hi. Thank you.
Policy in running the club basically is to let everybody have a good time. People trouble at minimum. So people enjoy themselves. Have a good night out.
And then when I've been talking around the club to your customers, they're saying there is nowhere else in Newbury or the surrounding areas as good as this. What would you say to that?
Well, hopefully that's the way they carry on thinking and keep using us. I mean, we're about the only place in town that's got open till 1 o'clock. I mean, everybody seems to enjoy themselves, so that's what we try to make people enjoy themselves. We'd like you all to come on down to Gatsby's and start enjoying yourself with the rest of this lot.
As Valentine's Day approaches, take a look at what WH Smith's has to offer. If you spend £5 or more in our high street store, including the price of your Valentine's card, you'll receive a voucher worth 10% off any purchase at a local Interflora shop in town. So, come down to WH Smith's, the high street.
Right, well, there's been talk that there's a resurgence in house prices. I'm not too sure if that's true or not, but to find out what's happening in Andover and all the way around, we went along to a Morris Dibbens to ask them what was going on there. So here we go. Here's a house price report in Andover. Right, we're well into the new year now, and we've come to ask Stuart Graham of Morris Dibbens, down at the bottom of the high street, in fact, on the Winchester Road, what's happening in the Andover property scene. So, Stuart, Happy New Year.
Thank you, and to you too. Well, the local market has actually seen quite good movement towards the end of last year, particularly leading up to Christmas, which was a big surprise to us. particularly with older style properties in the town, the likes of Salisbury Road, Winchester Road, the older established houses, which cannot be replaced, obviously, they're showing a great deal of movement and good interest across the board, really.
How are prices holding up? Are they, you know, mortgage rates are being talked about going up again?
Mortgage rates did go up, obviously, early in January, but it was only 0.25%. And that's not really enough to affect the local market that much. And once again, it's the older style properties that hold their value very well. There's been some newer developments built in the past couple of years, and that tends to affect the houses that have been built in the last 10 to 20 years. But all the other properties in the older style price range, they hold their value exceptionally well.
So what's happening outside of Andover? Are cables going into Luggershall and Salisbury? Do you go much out of Andover?
We cover quite a lot of the local villages, particularly to the south, because we've got offices in Romsey and Winchester. So we're obviously covering that area reasonably well. And the village market is always extremely buoyant because there's such a shortage of properties, and it's a good commuter area for people to go to London, Basingstoke, Newbury, Salisbury, Southampton. All those areas are covered very well from this sort of central source.
Well, back to town, what should people be looking at as a bargain, do you think?
Oh, is there such a thing as a bargain? You know, Marks and Spencers don't even have bargains anymore.
You're not having a January sale.
We're not having a January sale, no, because, of course, we don't govern the prices. It's the owners themselves that govern what sort of prices that they're sold for. I don't think there's ever going to be a desperate bargain, but don't forget, when you move house, you're really shuffling paper, and unless you're really wanting to put the money in the bank, it's best to just get on and sell and buy as soon as possible while prices do hold out and don't go up too much.
Okay, splendid. Well, we're going to be coming back time after time to talk to you about the Andover property scene and give the viewers some advice. Any hot tips at the moment?
Hot tips is buy now before prices go up too much later in the year.
Keep in touch.
Okay, thanks, Al.
Thanks, Stuart.
Bye-bye. Bye.
I've often wondered how a valley such as this in the southern part of England, with its fine waterways and meadows, can turn into this. Andover, a small market town in central southern England. And if you want to know the beginnings of this town, you have to travel back in time around 2,000 years to the south. 55 years BC, all the continent and most of Scandinavia had its own way with England right up until that date. Marauding hordes of Vikings and Saxons often plundered England from these waters here in the south. But at 55 BC, it suddenly all changed. A new breed of people were crossing the channel, and from Gaul, which is now called France, came the Romans, who built this fort here at Porchester. And from then on, as soon as they'd formed a base here, they moved north and west. And this is where Andover came into being, because the first time Andover reaches the map is as Andoveris. So Andover owes its very existence to the Romans. But what did the Romans actually do for us? They gave us the name of Andover. What else did they give us?
Drains.
Drains? Yes.
Drains?
Drains.
Yeah, but apart from drains and Andover, what else did they give us?
Viaducts.
Viaducts, yeah.
Viaducts, that's a good one.
Yep. Yeah, but apart from viaducts and drains and Andover, I mean, really, come on, what did the Romans give us?
They gave us some laws as well.
Yes, but apart from the laws and the viaducts and the roads and the drains, what really did the Romans do for us?
Language, yeah.
Yeah, but language, roads, drains, I mean, you know. Okay, now come on, let's get serious. We're on our way to Winchester, which is the old capital of England, where a king used to rule called Alfred. And there's a good little story that goes along with that about Alfred burning the cakes. And he was evidently in an old lady's cottage after a battle, and she asked him to look after the bread. But while she was out getting some water, Alfred was worried about the battles to come. And when she came back, she noticed that the bread was burning, and she said, "Alfred the Great." Can you believe that? So here we are at Winchester, and as you see behind me, King Alfred. As the Romans did move and push far further north, for about 300 years they stayed here in England, building up our cities, our towns. But when they left, it left a vacuum. And Alfred was one of the first kings to get his act together. One thing that the Romans did give us was straight roads. And this one runs from Winchester right through to Andover. It is dead straight. All of the turnings on there are on the new part of the road. But in actual fact, you can follow this road even by farm track right through to Andover. Just one day's march from Winchester to Salisbury, and just north of Salisbury is Old Sarum, an old Roman fortress. The Romans always built to the north of a town that they'd just conquered to stave off any attacks that might come in from the Celts. And about 13 miles west of Andover, I wonder what the Romans would have thought of this. Well, here we are back in Andover. I think you'll realize that Andover is central to everything that we've seen today. Easy accessible. This is Reg Presley for Andover Town Television, signing off.
Hello, I'm Bill Murray. I've lived around here for many years, but left about 10 years ago, and I've come back again. And I've come in here today to have a word with Bob Herbert, who runs the Andover Sale Room. And this is Bob. Hello, Bob. Nice to see you again.
Very nice to see you, Bill. Been welcome back. Time.
Thank you very much indeed. Bob, when did you start the Sale Room?
Actually, 16 years ago.
16 years ago. Mm. So I was, yes, of course, I was still here when you started it. Very successful, I would say.
But we're still here.
I think that's an indication that it's making good money, really. Do you mind if we have a look around inside?
Welcome, now, please do.
We've got to
make sure you buy something.
Bob, we're in your sale room now, and looking around, you've got some really interesting bits and pieces in here, from furniture to paintings and jewellery. Family plumbing, even, this piece of equipment here. Could you explain what this does, actually, Bob?
This actually would be a Regency commode armchair with, as you say, the fully fitted. And unused at present.
So there's a piece of early plumbing for you, and also the equipment for actually having a small bath is down here as well. Could you follow us this way? You still with me? What period is this, Bob?
That's actually, I suppose, early Victorian, William the Fourth, early Victorian.
And again, could you demonstrate what it does with me? there would have been a commode pan in there. Sorry,
yeah,
not
exactly
a commode.
Exactly right, it would have been, yes. It's actually been lowered. It's now the height of a, we won't say stool, we'll say footstool.
Right. Very unpleasant comment. Right, Bob, what else have you got? This is of great interest here. You mentioned the chest of drawers, which in the press
certainly
is being stripped over there. Can
yes,
you go and have a look?
Yes, have a good look at that.
Right, Bob, you are drawing my attention particularly to this chest. You're saying it's of interest. Could you tell me what it is, in fact?
It's actually Georgian, Regency Georgian, English, I think, mahogany. But the interesting thing is it had a crude paint on it and would have been completely ignored, thought to be only maybe a pine chest, till one sees it had a very thick veneer. That was a telltale. When it was all painted, one wouldn't have realised, but for the evidence of a chipped veneer.
So it's the thickness of the veneer which interested you particularly?
The thickness of the veneer showed it to be very early.
I see. Right. At the moment, it just could have been an old office chest of drawers or something.
Exactly.
Couldn't it?
Yes.
Right. Let's move on again then, shall we? This is a very interesting little chest we have here. There's a possibility it could have been an apprentice piece that would have been made by somebody who was apprenticed to a joiner of the period, or more likely, Bob thinks, it would be a traveller's sample, so that the joiner would make his full-size pieces, but rather than carry them round to show them to people to be sold, would say that this was what his type of furniture was, and then somebody would order from that. Is that the case, Bob?
That would be absolutely right. Yes, Bill.
Right.
Well done.
So an interesting piece. Also, we've got a tea caddy here. Another type of tea caddy behind you, which is called a sarcophagus type for fairly obvious reasons.
Regency.
Of the Regency period, as Bob is pointing out to me. There's so much in here, one could go on all day just talking about it. There's a large selection of paintings inside, which we've tried to film for you, but unfortunately, because it's a bit dark inside, we can't see them very well, so we have brought a small representative selection outside to show you. And here we've got three pictures. One is a very dark scene inside a manger or a barn after the painter Morland. You can see here that there's a gentleman with his stick, and there's a calf here, we think, and a very large mastiff-type dog. Now, Morland was very well known for his horse paintings as well, so that's an interesting piece. Bob, what do you think about that one?
I'd agree with you exactly. Whether it was sand cleaning, I'll be doubtful. I think it has great appeal in its natural state, showing just a little glow from either from outside or maybe from a fire.
Yes, strongly lit with a spotlight over it would bring it to life inside the house.
Certainly, yes, agree with you.
And then there's this little watercolour down here, or possibly a gouache, we think, of a stream and a gentleman fishing it. Nice sky, nice little bit of white water in there. It's quite a nice, pretty little picture that, isn't it?
Very pleasant. Such a contrast to the previous one you've looked at, yes.
Any sort of clue as to what that might make in auction?
Sort of 50 plus, I would expect.
Right. Bit expensive for me then, wasn't it?
Oh, rubbish. Go on, Bill.
This actually is my personal fun favourite, this little family yachting party at the back here. I can't read the name of the artist, actually. Do you know who it's by?
Can't help you, Bill.
No. But it's a little fun painting, isn't it? It's an oil.
Yes, I remember it's the type of painting which years ago you came in here and would buy, often for £1 or £2 only, and I imagine you've collected them and done very well since.
Do you think I might be able to do the same again at this picture sale?
Have a go. Please
do. I'll do that. Right, we're inside the sale room again, and I'd like you to meet Jane Hennery, who's Bob Herbert's assistant on the jewellery side. Jane?
Now, could you tell me something, please, about what we have here? There's four little pieces we've set aside, which are quite interesting. There's a fob watch, or what looks like a fob watch over there.
A sovereign case.
It's in fact a sovereign case
here, that's right. A metal.
Would that have been worn on a chain like a watch?
Probably on an Albert.
On an Albert, a chain, watch chain. Right. And what else have we got there? That crescent shape.
The crescent brooch, which is mounted on silver, with paste stones and simulated rubies. And that would be sort of late Victorian, turn of the century.
So, late Victorian, turn of the century. What sort of value would you put on that?
Probably, auction price, 35, 45.
So really quite cheap.
Yes, not too bad.
And good value.
Yes.
Really, yes.
It
very nice.
Do a little bit more.
Right. And we have here a paste buckle of a shoe or not?
Probably a belt.
A belt buckle.
Belt, yeah.
Right. And again, what period would that be?
I'm not sure on that one. That may be late Victorian again.
Right.
Right.
And you did mention this gold heart as being quite interesting because
yes.
It doesn't open.
No, it's hollow, but it's a pendant.
That is unusual because, of course, originally heart lockets were made to open because you had a picture inside of a loved one.
That's a little bit unusual. Not plain rare, but I mean, we don't often have...
Fairly unusual to be solid, so there's something else to come a bid for because it's different for a change. Thank you very much, Jane.
Okay, thank you.
Just before we finish here today, there's one thing that really interests me, and it's this bell in a cage. It looks very maritime, Bob, doesn't it?
Could be. I'm not going to be committed.
You're
that.
A bit cagey on that.
Yes.
So perhaps a school bell?
Yeah, I think that's probably more like it.
More
actually.
Like it. And so the cage would be stop the children getting in and vandalising it, you think?
Today it certainly would.
What sort of period?
Oh, early, Georgian, it's super wrought iron. I like the stand, the twirls of the stand.
Right.
Lovely, true wrought iron.
Blacksmith no, made, obviously.
Blacksmith made, no modern weld at
no.
all.
Very interesting piece of work, I think, to finish the show on. When's your next sale, Bob?
Well, these things you've seen, unfortunately, will have already been sold. We have fortnightly sales, the pictures and jewellery on the Saturdays, and everything else other than the pictures and jewellery on the Monday.
Right, thank you very much, Bob. And that, I think, just winds up the show. My name is Bill Murray. Nice to see you all again. Goodbye. The hat. George Melly's sign is that hat. And he's here in Andover tonight to give a lecture on surreal art. This is something that's been close to his heart since he was at school. And it's going to be a very interesting lecture, and I've got the man sitting here himself at this moment. It's nice to see you again after so many years.
I've been about.
You certainly have. Yes.
It's one of those things, wherever I go, people come up of my age group or slightly younger and say, I haven't seen you since 1954 or something like that. And I say, you didn't like it very much.
You're here tonight to do one of your lectures on art, surrealism
yeah.
in particular.
Well, Picasso on this
Picasso
occasion.
In particular.
Yes, although he drew very close to the surrealists in the early 30s, but he was never of them.
Right.
He influenced them and they was fond of them.
What is your interpretation for the benefit of our viewers of, in fact, surrealism?
Well, that's... how long have you got? A couple of hours?
Well, no...
No, you wanted two...
Let's pre-see the lecture.
Yes, yes. All right, well, surrealism... The surrealists believed that mankind is incomplete because he locks his unconscious and his desires and his fantasies and his imagination up in the dungeons of the mind and only allows the logical and sensible side to rule his life. And they feel that he is therefore only half a creature, really. And so they attempted by various means, by automatism, letting the thoughts come out automatically and writing them down without censorship or thought, and by painting pictures which seem to open windows onto a landscape that we have forgotten but is there, and through works of literature previously, like Alice in Wonderland, to uncover the hints and clues that indicate that we are not a complete person, but could be if we became surrealist. Surrealist, after all, any means above realism. But they never, as some people imagine, thought to suppress logic, common sense, the world as we know it. They just hoped to allow the other side of one as much say. It's almost as if they wanted to give the night an equal balance with the day, or the dream equal balance with the waking self.
Sounds much more complex than I'd imagined to start with.
Well, is that complex?
One tends to think of surrealism as applying to art, but it's also a poetic form of it, isn't it?
It started as literature, or at least anti-literature to be precise. Right. The first surrealists were mostly poets. But of course the advantage of art as a means of spreading the ideas of surrealism is that it speaks universal language, it doesn't speak French or English or Spanish or whatever, so that it can be understood all over the world. People also are more quickly enchanted by the visual than by the poetic on the whole, and so people began to think of surrealism as a movement of painting, which it never was. In fact, André Breton started surrealism, always referred to painting. He loved painting, he had a marvellous eye, but he always referred to it as that lamentable expedient.
Having to put it on paper.
Yes, having to, not living it, you see.
Oh, right, yes. I think possibly the man in the streets idea of surrealism is possibly Dali. Does he fit into your scheme of things?
Well, he did. Dali was a genius and a near madman in the early 30s and the late 20s. Came out of Spain like a young bull, a roaring young surrealist bull. And surrealism was going through a particularly difficult patch at that moment. It was politically confused. It was drawn towards communism because it was violently opposed to fascism. But the communists, of course, had no time for it whatsoever. They wanted pictures of people making tractors or raising their hands.
Yes,
and so they told them to go away, and the surrealists were very upset because they believed in social as well as in mental revolution. And Dali sort of saved the day because he was such a brilliant exhibitionist and his images were so extraordinary that he reanimated surrealism.
They actually meant something to the man in the street as well, these pictures.
Well, because of the exactitude of his painting, yes. They were impressed by that. They might have thought the subject matter was bad, but they couldn't deny him a brilliance of execution.
The bending watches, for instance.
The bending watches, and also the images were very perplexing for them, but they were realized as if they were photographs of real objects.
Exactly.
But unfortunately, with Dali's case, he was married to a very monstrous woman called Gala, a Russian, who saw that the surrealists were useful to him for a bit, but she was very, very greedy. And when she found the surrealists no longer needed them, he was famous enough as his own right, they cut with surrealism in the most brutal manner possible. Surrealism had been left-wing revolutionary and atheistic. So Dali, when he decided the time had come to make quite certain they would have nothing more to do with him, proclaimed the glory of General Franco and the Pope and the Mediterranean, and of course that rode him out of the surrealists. Although Breton was very sad to see him go because he was a great public manifestation of the surrealist spirit.
Your interest started when you were at Stowe School.
Yes.
And you were very much influenced.
Well, thanks for watching this week's show. Hope you enjoyed it. It's quite cold here in Andover, but We're having a great time, but anyway, as I said before, keep ringing us on Andover 333 983. We want to know your news and views. You've got any grouses or anything in particular about Andover? Or anywhere come to that, give us a ring on 333 983. And as I say, keep on watching the show. Thanks for watching, Andover. Bye.